All those years, every time I stopped, I saw myself as a deprived smoker. I was depriving myself of smoking. So therefore, I was still thinking smoking. I didn't see myself as a non-smoker. I saw myself as a deprived smoker. And when I got to that part in the program, it just went bingo. Like, it was just like, it was a massive light bulb moment for me. And that really helped me to, you know, change my thinking. But for me, the program worked because I did the program exactly as you tell us that we should do the program. And I didn't try and mess around. I did all the exercises. I did all the videos. I followed it in accordance with how it's laid out. And, you know, to be honest, I really enjoyed every moment of it.
Hi, everyone. This is Nasya Davos, and welcome to this episode of Ask an X. Every Ask an X episode features an inspiring ex-smoker who succeeded with the CBQ method and who shares their personal experience and unique perspective on quitting smoking. Now, the ex I have with me today quit smoking on July 8th, 2022 with the CBQ program, and he's here today to tell you how he did it. Please welcome Tim Roberts. Tim, welcome, and huge, huge congratulations on your success.
Thanks, Nasya, and thanks for having me. It's a pleasure to be here and pleasure to have the opportunity to try and share our experience, strength and hope so that we, you know, hopefully others will gain something from it.
I'm sure they will, and I cannot wait for us to dive in. Can you first take me back to the start, and how did you start smoking and why did you want to quit?
So I started smoking, I'm in the older age group, so I'm 68 now. So I started smoking when I was 14. My two older brothers, who were 2 years older and 5 years older than me, they were smokers, and our whole family was smokers. Really, it was back in the days, like we're talking in the late 60s, early 70s, when, you know, I think something like, 70% of the Australian population were smokers. And everywhere you went, people smoked. And, you know, it didn't matter whether it was at a restaurant or in a car or, you know, everywhere people smoked. And I guess it was just a done thing. And I started smoking the same as my brothers, and I loved it. And, you know, I became addicted to it pretty quickly because, you know, it took me quite a few years to work out my addictive personality, but I became addicted to smoking pretty quickly. I loved it. And then from there, I guess, you know, I smoked until the age of pretty heavily. I was a reasonably heavy smoker at times. It depended, my level of smoking really depended on my level of drinking or in fact other drug taking. So, you know, I think probably my preferred vice was always smoking, but I continued on until the age of 35, and then I stopped smoking at the age of 35. I actually stopped drinking at the same time, and I gave up the cigarettes pretty much straight away after I stopped drinking, and then I didn't smoke for 20 years, and then. There's a change in my life. My first wife died, and I had a new partner in life, and I picked up a drink again. And when I picked up a drink, I picked up a cigarette, because the two things were kind of intrinsically bound in together for me. And then I smoked again. I didn't start smoking very heavily. I never went back to smoking the same level that I'd smoked previously. I was really sort of more of a, you know, 6 or 7 cigarettes a day type person, you know, sometimes 7 or 8, but never much more than that. Then I decided I wanted to stop again, and I'd stop drinking again. And, but this time when I tried to stop smoking, I really struggled. You know, the first time around, it was kind of like I just stopped, and it was kind of, you know, cold turkey, and, you know, because I'd stopped drinking, I think it was a bit easier. But then this time around, I really struggled, and I struggled for a number of years. And, every time I tried to stop, I, you know, I'd go for a short period. I might go a few days, I might go a few weeks, but, you know, inevitably I'd come back to it and, you know, I'd start going back to the routine of smoking again. Yeah, so that's how it happened.
Wow,
And what,
what a journey it has been for
yeah,
you.
yeah.
And you also you have quit alcohol now, if I'm not
yeah,
mistaken.
yeah. So it's been about 10 years since I stopped drinking again.
Wow, congratulations.
And you know, but I couldn't put down the cigarettes for some reason, you know, and I just I tried, and it became a real bone of contention in my relationship. So my partner doesn't like smoking, never has, and never wanted to be with a smoker. And, you know, gave me several ultimatums about, you know, stopping smoking. And I kept on saying, yes, I will, and I promised I will. And then just before COVID, we packed up with our young daughter and rented out our house and bought a camper trailer and a four-wheel drive, and we started traveling around Australia right before the beginning of COVID. So people know Australia. We have a part of it, Western Australia, which is on the western side, which is a really big part of our state of Australia. It's about a third of the whole of Australia. And we ended up in Western Australia when COVID hit, and we stayed there for a whole year. I hardly saw anything of COVID because WA was all locked down. And again, I tried in that period to stop, you know, I really tried hard. I really, you know, really was thought that I was committed to it, but I just, you know, I'd stop for a bit and then I'd just go back to it. You know, whatever had happened, I'd pick them back up again and away I'd go again. And then it was kind of, you know, others will identify with this. It's, you know, the guilt started to get me, you know, I felt really guilty about it because I was putting my relationship under pressure and I didn't feel good about smoking at all anymore. You know, just like I was doing it, but I just didn't feel good about it. I didn't enjoy it. And yet I couldn't seem to stop. Well, you know, I couldn't seem to put them down and stay stopped. That was the thing. You know? And then one day I was just, you know, I was thinking, maybe I need some help, because I always thought that because I'd previously done it myself without any help and because I'd always been able to do that and stop drinking, I thought, you know, well, I should be able to do this. But I got to the point of realizing that I just couldn't. And so I was searching around the internet and looking for it. And I happened on one of your posts for a free seminar or a free session that was coming up that you could join and, you know, no obligation. And I think probably it was, you know, that your introduction to that, I kind of identified with you personally. In the way that you spoke and how you talked about your experience, strength and hope. And that really resonated with me. And I went, oh, okay, well, maybe this is something, you know, that I can work with. So I did that session. And before the session was even finished, I signed up because I just knew that there was something there that I needed.
And now that you've done the program, you're coming up 2 years. How was the experience inside the program? How was the process? Was it what you hoped and expected?
Look, I'd say that the program and the process was exactly what I expected. Like there was, you know, I took everything on face value. I've said this on the Facebook page to others as well who struggle. And I've said, look, the simple thing with this program is just follow it to the letter, right? Don't try and reinvent the program. Don't try and adjust the program. Don't try and, you know, customize it to suit you, because that's not how it works. It works because it's a structured program designed to change your thinking and designed for you to be able to see yourself as a non-smoker as opposed to seeing yourself as a deprived smoker. And I think that was the breakthrough for me in the program. The breakthrough for me in the program was the part of the program where you talk about, you know, becoming a non-smoker and not seeing yourself as a deprived smoker, because I think that's what I'd been doing all those years. Mm-hmm. All those years, every time I stopped, I saw myself as a deprived smoker. I was depriving myself of smoking. So therefore, I was still thinking smoking. I didn't see myself as a non-smoker. I saw myself as a deprived smoker. And when I got to that part in the program, it just went bingo. Like, it was just like, it was a massive light bulb moment for me. And that really helped me to, you know, change my thinking. But for me, the program worked because I did the program exactly as you tell us that we should do the program. And I didn't try and mess around. I did all the exercises. I did all the videos. I followed it in accordance with how it's laid out. And, you know, to be honest, I really enjoyed every moment of it. That was the, you know, that was the thing. I mean, the one thing I didn't do was I didn't follow right through on the cutting down on the smoking. I actually stopped smoking, I think, on day three or day four, because I was already really committed by that stage. And I think that's about the stage that you started talking about the, you know, thinking of yourself as a non-smoker as opposed to a deprived smoker. And I didn't see myself as deprived anymore.
I didn't, that's awesome. I didn't know you actually quit smoking earlier in the program. You just, when you had that moment, that aha moment, you were ready and you still followed through with everything else in the program until the end.
Yeah, but I think you say that, and I think you said that in around about day three or day four, which is, you know, keep going. But if you, you know, if you feel that if you feel that you don't want to smoke, well, then don't smoke, right? And I think the other thing that really works, and I think that people really need to try, and those people that are struggling with it, I found it worked really, really, it was incredible, was to just go that first hour of the day, right, without a cigarette. Start, like, get to an hour, all right? And if you can go for an hour, you'd be amazed at, you know, how quickly you sort of go, oh, well, you know, I had an hour and I didn't have to have a cigarette, all right? And it wasn't, you know, it wasn't purgatory or anything. I wasn't sweating for a cigarette or whatever. It was just that, you know, I followed what you said and said, give yourself an hour in the morning when you first start your day and don't have a cigarette. And, okay, it worked. Right? So the craving mind doesn't go away. It doesn't disappear. You just silence it, or you quieten the voice. You know, the voice gets quieter and quieter as you work on it and you think in a different way. And, you know, the craving mind gets less and less. But it's always there, right? It's just that if you think in the different way, you can put it to sleep, right? And so that little voice that goes, oh, it's 5 o'clock, you know, it's time for a drink, or oh, it's 5 o'clock, it's time for a cigarette, or, you know, I would normally, you know, oh, we've just had a meal, I'd normally go outside and have a cigarette, right? Those thoughts are still there, and occasionally they will pop up, but because you've changed your mindset to not listen to that, so I don't, you know, I'm not listening to that voice anymore, it goes away really fast. You know, it's kind of like, oh, well, you know, I'm not listening to that. Or I think in the program, there's one stage in the program where you talk about, like, actually talking to the craving mind and telling it to go away, right? And I actually really took that to heart in the program, and, you know, using some good Australian vernacular, I would actually tell that, you know, that craving mind to well and truly nick off, right? And I would, you know, I'd do it verbally, like I'd actually verbalise it
out loud, rather than,
yeah, out loud. You know, I'd verbalise it out loud, right? Because I needed to, because it was so strong. Like, that craving mind when you first stop smoking is so strong that it's, you know, you've got to get in charge of it. You know, you need to, and that's what the program did, right? It taught me how to realize that the craving was, you know, the craving mind, with all the triggers of the craving mind and the tricks that it plays and the way that it wants to try and get you to smoke, because that's what it's trying to get you to do. It's trying to get you to smoke, just as it was trying to get me to drink, just as a really obsessive food eater, it was telling me to eat. So I'd walk past the refrigerator, and my craving might be going, oh, there's a nice piece of cake in the fridge. You know, do you think you'd actually, can you hear that cake calling you? I can hear that cake calling you. You really want to eat that cake, Tim, don't you want to eat that cake? Right? Same thing.
Right?
Which is why when I came to actually, you know, doing the hard yards to lose the weight for the surgery and, you know, achieve what I wanted to achieve, I had to apply the same principles from CBQ to my craving mind for food, because that's what was driving me to eat. And that was what was making it hard for me to lose weight and to keep the weight off, is because the craving mind would come back and go, oh, you know, walk past the cupboard and go, you know, there's some chocolate biscuits in that cupboard, Tim. You know, there's some chocolate biscuits in there. You know, just, you know, rich in there, aren't you? Just over there, just go and get them. But not, again, not deprive yourself, right? Because the deprivation is the antithesis of the recovery, right? So it's like, if you deprive yourself, then you'll fall back into this thing about feeling bad that I'm deprived, that I can't sit on my balcony and have my glass of ginger beer at 4 o'clock, or I can't go and have my coffee in the morning, or, you know, because I'm deprived. Well, no, you can still go and do those things. You're just not going to have a cigarette.
Yes, absolutely. Feeling deprived does not allow you to actually develop the skill of silencing the craving mind. Yeah. It makes the craving mind louder. And that's why the program emphasizes no willpower and use mind power instead. Tim, so you quit smoking. Not only you didn't gain weight, but you applied all these principles and the method, and you actually lost weight. Can you tell me about that? Because it's an incredible transformation that you've done.
So I had a number of internal hernias in my stomach that I've had for a long time from a motorcycle accident when I was drunk when I was 19, and I've carried that into my older age, and I've got a few other things, you know, other stuff that I've had to have fixed, but eventually I had these hernias, and I actually need to do something about them, because we're planning on traveling again at the end of next year. Our daughter will finish high school, and we've got a catamaran, and we're going to pack up and we're going to sail off into Asia and wherever it takes us. But I wanted to get these fixed. And so when I went and saw the surgeon in the middle of last year, the surgeon said, yep, you need to get these fixed, but I won't operate on you. Two things, she said, I won't operate on you if you're smoking, and I won't operate on you unless you lose 20 kilos. Right? So they were her absolute, you know, rules. Like, no smoking and lose 20 kilos. And I went, well, I don't have to worry about the smoking, because I'd been off the cigarettes for a year by then. But I did need to lose weight. I was significantly overweight, and, you know, so I just said, well, what am I going to do? And a bit like the smoking, you know, I've been a yo-yo as far as my weight's concerned. You know, I'd go through that. I'd do a keto diet, or I'd do some other diet for, you know, 6 weeks, and I'd lose 15 kilos, and I'd go, look at that. And then I'd stop, and then I'd put it all back on again. Right. So I'd go up and down. So because I wasn't changing my mindset, I wasn't changing the way that I thought about it, I was still seeing myself as a deprived eater, right, which is the way I described it, right? I can't go and eat the things that I want to eat because, you know, they're not good for me, or, you know, but then I feel deprived. So I just sat back and thought about it and went, well, really, I just need to apply the same principles here. Right? So I need to see myself as not as a deprived eater, but I need to see myself as somebody who wants to change the way that they eat, wants to change the way that they do that. So, you know, so I did, you know, so I started on that, you know, journey, and I also got a dietitian to help me, because I needed to make sure that I didn't want to do any fad diets. I didn't want to do, you know, the no carbs or any of that. I just wanted to basically eat good food, but I didn't want to go on a diet per se. Right? Now, the thing that I learned very quickly in that process was that the biggest problem that I had was that I was an overeater. I just ate too much food. Right? I was just, you know, instead of eating a 100-gram piece of steak, I'd eat a 400-gram piece of steak. Or instead of having one slice of bread, I'd have five slices of bread. You know, so I was just an overeater. And what the program helped me do was it helped me see that I was an overeater, And it helped me deal with the mindset that kept saying to me, "Oh no, you can have another piece of that bread, Tim. You know, you're okay. You've only had one. You can have two, right? Or you can have four." But I had to re-educate myself using the program, you know, tools and philosophy to apply it to my thinking when it came to food.
So
that worked for me.
Interesting. You said you were an overeater, so it was the stopping that was the problem, or it was feeling you need more before you actually eat.
So it was just feeling that I wanted to eat as much as I wanted to eat, because for some reason I felt entitled to eat whatever it is that I wanted to eat, right? So I never considered the volume of food that I was eating. I never considered, you know, I've always eaten pretty well, like in terms of lots of fresh fruit and vegetables, and you know, we don't eat processed food generally and all that sort of stuff. Mm-hmm. But I was just eating too much. I was eating too much red meat. I was eating too much, you know, I was just eating too much of all of that. And, you know, once I, with the dietitian, I worked out a more balanced approach to it. Then I had a plan for what I was going to eat, but then I had to deal with what was going on up here, right? And that's when I applied the, you know, the same thinking from the CBQ program, you know, to still that craving voice in me that kept on telling me it's okay, you can go back to the fridge, you know, it's all right, you know, you can go and graze, because I was a grazer, right? So I could, and particularly because I work from home, you know, I run my business from home, so you know, I'd go past the fridge, you know, 6 or 8 or 10 times a day to go and get a coffee or water or whatever, and every time I'd go past the fridge, you know, I'd open the door, and I wouldn't necessarily actually eat anything.
Check what's there.
I just opened the door to make sure that all those things that were in there that were talking to me were actually in the fridge. You know, like, oh yeah, that bit of lamb is there, or that sausage is there, or you know, the cheese is there, right? And I'd just stand there and look at it, and then I'd close it and I'd walk off, right? And like I became so unaware that was a mindset and habit that I developed, that you know, and probably in 80% of the time, I would reach into the fridge and get something and eat it, right? But I wasn't really conscious that I was actually eating it. You know, it was just that I was opening the door and the mind had taken over. Mm. And I think, you know, and again, look, people that have struggled with their weight and stuff is, you know, they all have their own experience. They all have their own journey around it. But for me, it was so similar to the smoking that, you know, when I applied it, the principles to the eating, it just worked, you know? But now I have to continue to practice it, just as I have to continue to practice, you know, the non-smoking, and you know, the same with not drinking. You know, it all becomes part of a daily routine and practice that you've got to keep. You've got to stay mentally fit. You know, you need to stay mentally on top of it.
Yeah, absolutely, and I second your experience. It works exactly the same way for those craving thoughts of food or emotional eating, because when we've learned through life to respond to our emotions by reaching something external, that becomes the craving mind, and then we have to learn how to silence it. Can you tell me a bit more about the nutrition plan you followed and how actually you took control of your craving mind? I hear from what you're saying that becoming aware that there was a pattern, there was an unconscious habit and way of thinking about food was a big part of it. Tell me a bit more about how you did it, because I know a lot of people want to hear that story and will benefit tremendously, especially those who worry about weight gain after quitting smoking, which we talked about earlier, that it's a big worry, but doesn't have to be true.
So I think, Nasia, that it goes back to, you know, as the program taught me to not see myself as a deprived smoker, but to see myself as a non-smoker. What I had to educate myself to was to not see myself as a deprived eater. right? And that I was going to be a normal eater, right? Rather than being a deprived eater, because I'd always seen myself as a deprived eater. When I'd go on a diet, or when I was trying to control my weight, I'd be going, oh, like I really want that scone and jam and cream, but I'll only have one, but one would become two, right? Because you'd given in. I'd given in to the craving. I'd given in to the craving. I'd given in to the minds that said you can, you can eat that scone and jam and cream, right? For me, it was I just had to apply that every time I thought about food. And what I didn't realise until I actually started applying it was I didn't realise just how much I actually thought about food. Like I would think about food all the time. I'd get up in the morning and go, what am I having for breakfast? And I'd no sooner have breakfast than I'd be thinking about, well, when am I going to have another coffee, and can I have a snack with a coffee, and then what am I going to have for lunch, and then I'd be planning dinner, and even when talking about dinner, I'd be thinking about, well, what am I going to have after dinner when I have my cup of tea, what biscuit am I? So it was like I just didn't realise how much I was mentally draining myself with this obsession of food and thinking about food all the time, and this mindset, right? The good thing with the dietitian was the dietitian set up basically a framework for me and said, okay, well, I only want you to eat red meat once a week. I want you to, I only want you to eat this much protein. So he didn't set the portion sizes. He said, you've got to control your portion sizes yourself. I'll tell you what your portion sizes should be, but you have to learn to do that yourself. But I'll give you a structure which was, a lot more vegetarian, a lot less, which, I'd gone from eating, I used to eat red meat six, seven times a week. Gone to once, and now, even now, sometimes it's only once a fortnight. And I've replaced a number of those with vegetarian or plant-based meals, which I've come to enjoy a lot. I've really come to enjoy as much, if not more.
And you're feeling good, right? Like,
yeah,
change. Yeah. You're feeling good. It's not just the weight loss, which is extraordinary, 28 kilograms.
Yeah. So
60 pounds.
So,
wow.
Yeah. I mean, it is. It's a lot. And I mean, I'm at a weight now that I haven't been since my early 40s, or 30s. But it, it's it, it is this. I just lost control of my mind, right? When it came to food, just as I'd lost control of my mind when it came to smoking, just as I'd lost control of my mind when it came to drinking, and I had to regain that control, and then I had to learn a new pattern or a new way of doing things. So I think that's the thing. If we go back to the CBQ program for the non-stopping smoking, it is all about re-educating yourself and changing your mindset and understanding that, the difference between mind power and willpower.
And something that I think is very important to point out, you shared how it takes practice and it takes intention to keep your craving mind asleep and put it to sleep. And I think it's important to point out that you're doing all this so you can have freedom in your life, because when this craving mind takes over, you have no freedom anymore. So you're putting this work not so that you will change into someone else or so that you will not be yourself, but so that you can truly be free without the addiction shadowing your thought processes and your life. Does that describe accurately why you're doing this?
Yeah, 100%. 100%, right? So 100%, that's exactly how the way to describe it. And, I say to myself on a regular basis, I chose freedom. I chose to be free of the craving mind, and I chose that from the program and the learnings in the program to put down the cigarettes, but I've also chosen it now to use that in my life generally, right? And everything that I do is to say, you know, I'm going to choose freedom, which means I have to take action in relationship to whatever change it is that I want to make, right? And I think one of the things that people struggle with, and I know that, you know, to me, it was one of the great parts of the program, is that it taught me that it was okay to change, right? It was okay to accept the fact that I had to change, and it was okay to change, right? And by changing, I was actually picking a new path, and the path that I was picking, which you describe it as the path to freedom, right? So, and I think it's a great description, you know, to say that you choose freedom, because what you are choosing is you're choosing to be free of the craving mind. You're choosing to be free of, you know, the agony and the guilt and the frustration and all of the things that go with the smoking when you get to a point of going, I want to stop, but I can't, or I want to stop, but I don't know how to stop, right? I think once somebody reaches that point of genuinely wanting to stop and genuinely wanting to put the cigarettes down, then they are at a point where they can start to think about, you know, and start to change their mind and their mindset, and they can start to choose freedom, right? But they have to have got to that point, right? And I think for me, part of the reason why I struggled, you know, in those years that I really struggled to put them down and keep them, you know, stay down, was that I hadn't really chosen freedom at all, you know, because I hadn't really chosen to be a non-smoker. I'd chosen to see myself as a deprived smoker, right? Which is a fundamental, like it is a real fundamental. Yeah. And that's part of choosing freedom, you know? But it's a great description, Darcy. You know, I mean, the way that you described in the program, that resonated with me so strongly, right? When I, you know, choosing freedom, you know, it just resonated really, really strongly.
Yes, it's that phrase that I'm sharing at the end of every video was so intentional to encapsulate everything that this is about, making that choice and having the tools to make that choice easily and not struggle. And when you were describing that, a big takeaway for you is the program helped you realize that it's okay to change. I got goosebumps, because how many of us were afraid of change, afraid of the unknown, afraid of success, afraid of discomfort, afraid of losing part of ourselves. But just like you said, it's not about losing yourself. It's about losing baggage and making a new choice on your path. Very well said.
Yeah, and I think that when people that, you know, anybody's listening to this that's starting the program or is, you know, in the program is struggling a bit, I think that's something that they should really think about. You know, they should think about that, you know, I'm making the choice to get to unload that baggage, right? That's the choice that I'm making. I don't want that baggage anymore. I want to unload it. I want to choose something else. And what I'm choosing is I'm choosing to have a life without that baggage, right? Now, for me, that baggage, you know, that came in the form of smoking, but it also came in the form of overeating and, you know, and other things in my life, right? So I think, you know, choosing and saying to yourself, right? And I think the other thing is that, you know, the program is very much about doing the exercises and talking to yourself about this is what I'm doing, right? So talking to yourself positively about I'm doing this for this reason, or I'm doing this exercise, right? So it's all, again, it's all about changing the mindset. But you get to that point where, I think you get to that point in the program where you just, that has become a fundamental change in behavior. Now, for me, I think that happened like sort of day three or day four, but I see what other people say, and some people it doesn't happen until later in the program, right? Yeah. It doesn't happen until I actually put the cigarettes down on the last day, and then it kind of happens for them, right? So I think it happens to people in, you know, different times, But for all those people that have done it, I think the one thing that is common is that they have adopted the principle of choosing freedom. Well, I think for me, it just became exhausting. You know, like the whole guilt and the running around and hiding the smoking and hiding the cigarettes and making sure I cleaned up and put them in the rubbish and taking the rubbish out so you couldn't smell them. And, you know, like it was just exhausting.
Yeah.
It was just mentally and physically exhausting, right?
Yeah.
And I didn't realise how exhausting it was until that actually stopped. And, you know, I'd become aware of it, right? I became aware of how exhausting it was and how restricting it is. So, again, that's part of choosing the freedom. Like if you're not doing all that stuff, you're free of having to run around and hide things and hide the cigarettes and the smoking and the clothes and put things in the washing machine because they smell. And, you know, and I've got a little tip for the smokers out there. Like if you think that spraying the deodorant around and doing all that sort of stuff gets rid of the smell of cigarettes, I can tell you it doesn't. Right? You can't get rid of that smell.
Haven't we all done that?
Yeah, the only way you can get rid of that smell is to stop smoking.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Good tip. And there is another a quote I want to share. A quote from you that you said: "If you put the same amount of effort into the program that you have in smoking, you will succeed." And I thought this was brilliant because we do put a lot of effort in smoking, just like you described. The smell, the guilt, it takes over your life. And quitting is the only way to allow your true self to come out because it's...
And look, the other thing I've said to a few people is, you know, and this is true, you know, it's the same thing whether it's for me, any of my addictions, but the reality is that cigarettes are always going to be there. Right? They're always going to be there because there'll be a certain percentage of the population that will always smoke, and I don't think we'll ever get to the point that there is no smoking at all. But they'll always be there. You can always go to the corner store or the supermarket or whatever and buy a packet of cigarettes. Right? They're not going away. They're not going anywhere. So I say to people, like, well, just give it a try. Like, give yourself a chance here. Try it for, you know, the 12 days of the program, and then try it for a week or 2 weeks. And I guarantee that if you don't feel better after a couple of 3 weeks, you know, which you will, like you'll physically feel better because you'll stop coughing and you'll stop all that sort of stuff, then that happens pretty quick, as you explain in the program. Like it happens, the physical addiction stuff goes away relatively quickly, right?
Yeah.
So if you're not feeling better after 2 or 3 weeks, you know what? You can always go back to smoking if you want. Right. No one's going to follow you around and stop you from doing it. Right? But I'll guarantee that if you do this, you will feel better after 2 or 3 weeks. You just will, despite yourself, you'll feel better. Right? And then that's the opportunity to use that as a positive way of saying, I've chosen freedom and, you know, I'm feeling better. Why wouldn't I keep doing this if I feel better?
Yeah, good point, and very good point. Especially if someone is afraid to get started or hesitant or feeling like this all or nothing, that, oh my God, I'm going to quit smoking and I really don't want to. Just see how it, try.
Just give it a try. You've got nothing to lose.
Yes, right? Yes, yeah.
But when you actually have nothing to lose. Right?
Yeah.
And then you've got immediate gain. You know, you've got immediate health gain from day one. You've got immediate financial gain from day one because you're not spending $50 on a packet of cigarettes or whatever it is. I don't know what it is overseas, but it is that kind of here in Australia. You know, so like you've got immediate gain straight away. You know, there's no downside.
Exactly, especially after you have changed the mindset because everything is aligned. Yeah, thank you for sharing that. And Tim, what would you say to someone who watches this interview? They just learned about the CBQ method or the CBQ program, and you know they're skeptical. They don't know. Oh, does this work? Is it really gonna be possible for me? Because you mentioned that you have an addictive predisposition or personality. yet you've made so many changes in your life. So what would you say to this person?
Look, I think I'd say just what we said just before. I'd just say to them, you know, just give it a try. You've got nothing to lose. The thing is that you are looking at the CBQ program. You have connected in some way to this program, or you have investigated this program. Why are you doing it? You're doing that because you actually want to stop smoking, right? You're here not because you want to keep smoking. You're here because you want to stop smoking, right? So give yourself a chance. You've got nothing to lose by doing the program as it's laid out, you know, over that period of time and following the exercises and doing it. As I said, you know, if you get to the end of the program and you just go, you know, it's not for me, well, fine, it's not for you. But I seriously doubt that that will be the case, because you have got here in the first place because you want to stop smoking. You just haven't figured out how, and you haven't figured out the why. And what CBQ does is it helps you to figure out the why, and then it shows you the how. Right. So it you know, and this is really important, you know, it helps you to understand, why am I here? Why am I thinking about doing this program? Why am I listening to this video? Why am I doing this? Well, the reason why you're doing it is because you actually want to stop smoking. Right? Now the how is do the program and it'll work. So that's what I'd say.
Yeah, beautiful and so insightful, because truly, if someone is in doubt, if they really want it, if they can do it, what you're saying is trust that thing that brought you here.
Yeah.
Because there, it is there. Something inside of you wants to be free. So follow that. Yes.
Yeah, trust the why.
Yes.
Right. Just why am I here? I'm here because I want to be free of this, because I want to be free of the constant craving in my head. I want to be free of the guilt. I want to be free of, you know, I want to be free of all of the stuff that goes with this. Right? So that's, you know, so just trust the why as to why you're here, and then follow the program for the how, because the program will tell you how.
Amazing.
That's it.
Yeah, that's perfect. Thank you so much, Tim. Thank you so much for sharing your journey in such an open, honest, and insightful and helpful way. You actually shared a lot of practical tips for the mindset. I absolutely inspiring story, and what you have achieved in your life and the changes you've made so you can be free. Your example, I know it will help and encourage many others to quit smoking and even overcome that craving, the food craving, that food addiction like you did. So thank you so much.
Look, and Nasi, thank you for the opportunity to have this kind of fireside chat about it, which I really enjoyed. I really enjoyed doing this. And thank you to you for the enormous effort and work and, you know, everything that's gone in for you to build CBQ, and to the team that you've got and the support and everything else. Like, you know, it's a fabulous thing that you've done, the number of people that you've helped. You know, it's really incredible. So, yeah, it's a big thank you to you as well.
Thank you.